Episode number 336. The cardinal was, as we have said, in very low spirits, and nothing when he was in that state of mind increased his depression so much as gaiety in others. Besides, he had another strange fancy, which was always to believe that the causes of his sadness created the gaiety of others. Making a sign to loud in ear and Caius act to stop, he alighted from his horse, and went towards his suspected merry companions, hoping, by means of the sand, which deadened the sound of his steps, and of the edge which concealed his approach, to catch some words of this conversation which appeared so interesting. At 10 paces from the edge he recognized the talkative Gascon, and as he had already perceived that these men were musketeers, he did not doubt that the three others were those called the Inseparables, that is to say, Athos, Porthos, and Aramis. It may be supposed that his desire to hear the conversation was augmented by this discovery. His eyes took a strange expression, and with the step of a tiger cat he advanced towards the edge, but he had not been able to catch more than a few vague syllables without any positive sense, when a sonorous and short cry made him start, and attracted the attention of the musketeers. "Officer!" cried Grimaud. "You are speaking, you scoundrel!" said Athos, rising upon his elbow, and transfixing Grimaud with his flaming look. Grimaud therefore added nothing to his speech, but contented himself with pointing his index finger in the direction of the edge, announcing by this gesture the cardinal and his escort. With a single bound the musketeers were on their feet, and saluted with respect. The cardinal seemed furious. "It appears that messieurs the musketeers keep guard," said he. "As English expected by land, or do the musketeers consider themselves superior officers?" "Monseigneur," replied Athos, for amid the general fright he alone had preserved the noble calmness and coolness that never forsook him, "Monseigneur, the musketeers, when they are not on duty, or when their duty is over, drink and play at dice, and they are certainly superior officers to their lackeys." "Lackeys?" grumbled the cardinal. "Lackeys, who have the order to warn their masters when anyone passes are not lackeys, they are sentinels." "Your eminence may perceive that, if we had not taken this precaution, we should have been exposed to allowing you to pass without presenting your respects, or offering you a thanks for the favor you have done us in uniting us. D'Artagnan," continued Athos, "you, who but lately were so anxious for such an opportunity for expressing your gratitude to Monseigneur, here it is. Avail yourself of it." These words were pronounced with that imperturbable phlegm which distinguished Athos in the hour of danger, and with that excessive politeness which made of him at certain moments a king more majestic than kings by birth. D'Artagnan came forward and stammered out a few words of gratitude which soon expired under the gloomy looks of the cardinal. "It does not signify, gentlemen," continued the cardinal, without appearing to be in the least swerved from his first intention by the diversion which Athos had started. "It does not signify, gentlemen. I do not like to have simple soldiers, because they have the advantage of serving in a privileged corps, thus to play the great lords. Discipline is the same for them as for everybody else.